This is Good Friday. This is a well-trodden path for many, if not for all of us, this morning. And so we just sit quietly while this music is played before we sing it together. Song is 176, the words are here on the screen. If you're able, would you stand and we will sing this song through. And so we come this morning in prayer and adoration, in thanksgiving and worship. We come in bewilderment and puzzlement too. We come in wonder and doubt and fear. We see suffering and we ask why. We hear rumours and visions of war and we cry for peace. We want that this world should be fixed. Lord Jesus, we thank you that through the cross is the means of resolving the world's ills. This morning, we come again, once again, to the cross. Amen. Please be seated. And we listen to reading number one, please. Reading number one.
Mark 15. What shall I do with the one you call the King of the Jews? Pilate asked them. Crucify him, they shouted. Why, what crime has he committed? Asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, crucify him.
Song 208. When I survey the wondrous cross. Please remain seated to sing. Those of us who gathered yesterday evening for the Maundy Thursday reflection were drawn into the scenes of the upper room, the Garden of Gethsemane, and the palace courtyards. I invite you today to do similarly. I invite you to imagine that you are there. The crowd crying, crucify, could easily be any one of us. But as we move through these readings and these familiar songs, as we listen to music, may we be there, right at the heart of a scene which is so familiar to each one of us. As the crowds cried, crucify, so Jesus was taken away. We listen to reading number two, please.
The soldiers led Jesus away into the palace and called together the whole company of soldiers. They put a purple robe on him, then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" Again and again, they struck him on the head with a staff and spit on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him.
The journey from the palace to the place of crucifixion went through some of the narrowest streets in Jerusalem. It was the Via Dolorosa.
Thank you.
Imagine being on the road. Imagine being there. Imagine watching as the victims were hauled, roped, tied, tethered through the narrow streets of Jerusalem. Imagine watching one stumble and fall right in front of where you are. Imagine the voice of the soldier. You, take the cross. You take the cross. Psalm 203. There is a green hill far away without a city wall. If you are able, please stand to sing. Sit down. Reading number 3.
So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with another tomb, one on each side, and Jesus in the middle. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin and Greek.
Don't write that, they said. Write, he said he was the king of the Jews. Pilate said, what I have written, I have written. Mocking, always mocking. It was the only entertainment those soldiers had in the midst of a gruesome and terribly, terribly distressing scene. They wrote a sign. And then they stripped the victims. And there, on the ground, into their shields, they took the dice. How many did you get? Not enough. Roll again. You beat me. What's my prize? Well, all he had, really, just that linen garment. You know, the ones with the blood stains on the back. You take it. You take it. Signs and dice. The mocking. The stripping away. The taking away of everything that Jesus ever owned. There in that moment. What was he left with? If you take away everything you have, everything you own, everything you possess, what are you left with? The only thing that Jesus had. The only thing that he could give at that moment was the gift he gave to the man hung beside him. Reading 4.
Who hung there, hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God, he said, since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we're getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus answered him, truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise.
Thank you.
What is the gift? What did Jesus have left when everything else went to give you? Salvation. Your salvation. Your salvation was the only thing when everything else was stripped away. When Jesus was hung on the cross under a sign mocking his claim, wearing the crown of thorns, with everything else gone, he could still give you salvation. Do you accept that? Will you accept that? Will you take the gift that Jesus offers you again? And will you allow it to make a difference in your life? Can you say, Lord, remember me? Will you hear the voice of God in Jesus coming back to you, saying, today, today, you will be with me in paradise? As we reflect this morning, in our songbook, 481 is a simple chorus, familiar to many of us. To thy cross I come, Lord. This is a moment of response, if you wish. If God is saying to you, put down everything that is distracting you now. Look at the cross. See my gift for you. And as we sing the chorus, if you wish to respond and maybe come to stand or to kneel at the cross, then this morning, enter into the life of God, would you? Together. His gift given. There was nothing more that he needed to do. Reading number 5, please.
Luke 23. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon, for the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out in a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he had said this, he breathed his last.
It is finished. It is accomplished. Nothing more is required except for those who gathered at the cross to slowly, mournfully, thoughtfully make their way back to their homes. For that's what we will all do now. We will get up from here and we will go to our homes. We will go through the rest of the day. We will eat, drink. Some will nap. Some will go out with family and friends. Some will maybe go to work. What difference will this make this year for you? I was put in mind of the epilogue to the Shakespearean tragedy of Romeo and Juliet. Some of you will know it, be familiar with it. And I hope the great bard will excuse me if I slightly mangle his words this morning. But I thought how almost fitting it was for us who have sat here this morning, reflecting on this. For Shakespeare writes, "A glooming peace this morning with it brings. The sun for sorrow will not show its head. Go hence. To have more talk of these sad things." Some shall be pardoned, and some punished. For never was a story of more woe than Jesus, his cross, his crown of thorns, and his gift of life for you. We conclude our time here this morning with Psalm 164. Hark, the gospel news is sounding. Christ has suffered on the tree. Streams of mercy are abounding. Grace for all is rich and free. Now, poor sinner, look to him who died for thee. We invite you, if you are able, to stand as we sing the song through, please.
Thank you.
Father God, we thank you for Jesus, for his life, his ministry, his example, and his sacrificial gift. We pray now, as we go from this place, we may go with the image of the cross seared into our thinking, shaping all our words and actions, and drawing us and those we meet again to you. We pray this prayer in the name of the risen Jesus. Amen.